So just a reminder, if I have a triangle, that's my angle theta, this was my x, that was my r, and that's my y. We know that x over r equals cos theta, and y over r equals sine theta. Okay, so using these two, we learn that x equals r cos theta and y equals r sine theta. Okay, so here I'm not worried about vectors, I just want to know the relationships. So that's the relation between, so in most cases you'll be given r and you'll be given theta. You want to find x and you want to find y. So you can find x by using r cos theta, you can find y by using r sine theta. And this is always true as long as theta is the angle with respect to the x-axis. As soon as you have a vector whose angle is quoted with respect to the y-axis, so say theta is with respect to the y-axis, then how do you find the x and the y? We want to use x is r cos some angle, y is r sine some angle. So if we want to use that, we need to write the angle with respect to the x-axis. So this angle over here with respect to the x-axis will be 90 minus theta. So then we learn that rx, in this case, the magnitude, I'm not interested in the direction, will be, again, we use this equation over here. It's always true because now the angle we have is with respect to the x-axis. So we'll just have r cos. Now our angle theta is the angle 90 minus theta. So that's 90 minus theta. Then ry is equal to r sine theta, and theta here is 90 minus theta. Okay, so someone might be interested in simplifying this. Sometimes you have to simplify, so just remember that cos 90 minus theta is sine, so you learn that rx equals r sine theta, which behaves like a y component, and so ry equals r cos theta, and in this case it behaves like an x component. And this is useful when we look at a block on an incline, and we'll come back to this later on. The y component of the gravitational force we will find in this case is given by this formula, and the x component is given by this formula, which is very, very different from the general formula, but it has to do with the fact that the angle that's given is quoted with respect to the y-axis, and then the other angle, which is what we work with, will just be 90 minus that angle. Okay, so just make sure, just a small summary, a reminder, that the x component is given by r cos theta, the y component is given by r sine theta. The plus that I've put here and the minus that I've put here are just directions which we spoke about earlier. And if now you're given an angle with respect to the y-axis, you want to write down the angle with respect to the x-axis. And notice that when I'm drawing my components, I always start with the x, okay? Because then the diagram is more useful. I can use this angle. So start with your x. And in this case, this angle will be 90 minus theta. So my x component, in this case, the direction is positive. It's going to be r cos 90 minus theta, which is r sine theta. And my y component is r sine 90 minus theta. And 90 minus theta for sine is just cos. So yeah. So what's the general formula? So the general formula is this formula over here. So there's our main formula. We said r, any vector can be broken down into an x component and a y component, and the x component is given by The magnitude is given by r cos theta, where theta is the angle with respect to the x-axis, and the y component is given by r sine theta. And there were four different cases, so we could either have a plus minus for the x and a plus minus for the y, and depending on those different cases, so you can either have plus plus, plus minus, or minus plus, minus minus. So these are just to cover those different cases. Okay, so that's how we add vectors, and that's how we have vector components. Okay, so now we need to do some examples, and the examples we are going to look at are examples from the study guide. So if we now go to page, let's see first, okay, so page 37. So if we now go to page 37 and we're looking at question number 3, so just to show you what I'm talking about, so if you go to page 37, we're looking at question number 3, so page 37 of the study guide, we have the following diagram, and we're given a vector A, and they say vector A forms an angle beta with respect to the x-axis, and it's at an angle alpha with respect to the y-axis, and the question is, what is the magnitude of the resultant of these two vectors? And we've already looked at this, but let's just calculate so that we gain confidence. So how would you do this? You do it the following way. So just to redraw the diagram, remember this is page 37, and it's problem number 3. It's a multiple choice question, and let's see. So the diagram was, there's our y-axis, there's our x-axis, so let's just label them y, x, and then the vector A, which is at an angle theta with respect to the x-axis, and we have another vector B, which is at an angle alpha with respect to the y-axis. So the first thing we need to do is to find the angle with respect to the x-axis for B, and that angle is just 90 minus alpha. We always work with those angles with respect to the x-axis. And then now for the resultant, so just to see how it will look like, first we have A, it forms an angle theta with respect to the x-axis, and then we draw vector B, and B forms an angle 90 minus alpha with respect to the x-axis, and we said the resultant is always the vector from the starting point to the end point. That's our starting point, that's the end point, and the resultant is that vector R, which forms, say, some other angle gamma with respect to the x-axis. So the question was, what is the magnitude of this vector, which is just R? Okay, so R is given by the following formula. So R is the magnitude, which so if I drew R, remember that R also has two components. It has an x component, which we draw over there, and it has a y component over there, and these are perpendicular, so we've got a right angle triangle. So if we now use trigonometry or algebra, remember that the magnitude of this vector, or r squared, was given by x squared plus y squared, so that's what we're gonna use. So x squared, not times, so let's just remove the times. So x squared plus y squared is r squared, so we want r, we take the square root, and if we were interested in the direction, so the direction gamma is then given by, we know that, So there's our gamma over there. We know that tan theta is just the y over the x. So gamma is the inverse tan of the y component over the x component. Okay, so those two equations are very important, and they allow us to calculate vector components. Okay, so in this example, if we can just come back. So going back, what do we have? The x component, so the resultant x component is given by the sum of the two vectors. So it's got a contribution from the x of A plus a contribution from B. So the contribution from A, the x component of A is directed in the positive side of our convention. So the direction is plus, the magnitude is A cos the angle between the x-axis and the vector is just theta, so A cos theta. For B, we are going in the negative direction, so it's minus for the direction, and the component is the magnitude, which is B, and it's cos again, and the angle that we have between the vector and the x-axis is 90 minus alpha. And we said that if we now rewrite this, we get A cos theta minus cos 90 minus alpha is sine, so plus minus B sine alpha. Okay, so that's our resultant x component. Now we need the y component. So ry again is just the sum of vectors, so it's ay plus by. If we check our diagram over here, for the y component for A, I have to go up, which is positive, so plus, and then we said our formula is the magnitude, which is A, sine the angle between the vector and the x-axis, so A sine theta. And then for B, we are going down, so it's over there, which is minus for the sine, and we have the magnitude B, again we have sine, the angle that is between the x-axis and the vector is 90 degrees minus alpha. So simplifying this, we find that Rx, the x component vector, is A sine theta minus B sine 90 minus alpha is cos alpha. Okay, so now if we just plug in our answer in this formula over here, we find that the magnitude R, let's use a different color. So we find that the magnitude R equals the magnitude of X squared plus the magnitude of Y squared. And for X, we said X is over here. So we have A cos theta minus B sine alpha. And we need to square that. Then we need to add the y component, which is A sine theta minus B cos alpha, and it's also squared. So sorry about this, this should have continued all the way up to there. Okay, so that's all under the square root. And if we check our options, because this is a multiple choice question, we are looking for, so the first thing we are looking for is A cos beta, A cos theta. Okay, wait, so here with our final answer over there, I called this angle over here, I called it theta in the book. Theta is just beta, so substitute beta where we have theta. Okay, so we want an A cos beta in the first term, and we want a B minus B sine alpha in the second term of the first bracket. So now if we check in our book, we are looking for A cos beta minus B sine alpha. So the first option gives us A cos beta minus B sine alpha. That's correct. The second one is A sine beta. So we know that that option is wrong. We cross it out. A cos beta minus B cos alpha. That option is also wrong. We cross it out. A cos beta minus B sine alpha. So it's either A or C. Then now we look at the second term. And for the second term, what do we have? We want an A sine alpha, A sine beta minus B cos alpha. So now we go back and we check our options again. The first term and the last term were the ones which gave the only option for the, I mean, the correct x component. So the y component we are looking for is A sine beta minus B cos alpha. So this one is correct. If we check the last one, it's A cos beta, which is wrong. So then D is off. So the correct answer in this case is just A. Okay, so if we can just summarize, if you check over here, that's the full solution. And as you can see, I've just said the x component is given by the x component for A plus the x component for B, and that's the values, and that's our final answer for the x component. The same thing for y, that's our final answer. Then we use Pythagoras to find the magnitude, just plug in the answers, and that's option A. Okay, so question 3 in page 37, the correct answer is A. Then now let's move to do tutorial number 7, and that's on page 39. So tutorial number 7, page 39. So what do we have for tutorial number 7 on page 39? The statement is, calculate the resultant of the following vectors. So we need to calculate the resultant of three vectors. First, we have a vector A, which is at an angle 60 degrees with respect to the y-axis. So we don't want this angle over here. We always want the angle that it forms with respect to the x-axis. So then we will look at 90 minus 60, which is 30. Then B, we've got the magnitude is given as 91 kilometers per hour, and the angle that is quoted is the one that we want. And C only has an x component. So then how do we find the resultant? Remember that vectors have two things. So they have a magnitude and direction. So that's why there's two solutions. So let's see how we are going to solve that. So here's my solution over here. So the first thing we do, as I've said already, is we find the angle with respect to the x-axis. So if this is 60, that's 30 degrees. And then now our x component for the resultant is given by the sum of the x components of the three vectors. So if I just sum the x components of the three vectors, I will have ax, bx, and cx. And if you check for A, I'm going in that direction, so that's the negative. So I get negative, the magnitude for A is 20 kilometers per hour, so minus 20 cos the angle that is between the x-axis and the vector is 30 degrees. Then for B, I've got also minus, so minus the magnitude is 91, and we have cos 40. And then for C, C only has an x component, so it's just, and it's also in the positive direction, so plus 60. Okay, if we add these three, let's just make sure that you know how to add the three. So take your calculator. Okay, oops. So there's your calculator over there. So make sure that your calculator is in degrees. The way you do that is you go to mode. Actually, you say shift mode, and it gives you options. The option you want is 3, which is for degrees. So you press 3 on your calculator, and now it's in degrees. Okay, so then we say minus. So when you've got a minus in the beginning, you don't use this minus. You use this small minus in brackets. So minus 20, and we have cos 30. Don't forget to close the bracket. Then now you use the normal minus, which is the big minus. So minus 91 cos 40. And finally I add 60. So then the answer that we get is minus 27.0. So that's what I have here. So the minus is the direct. So our resultant vector is pointed in the negative x-axis direction. The magnitude is 27 and the unit is kilometers per hour. So here we're speaking about speeds. Then we do the same thing for the y. So for the y, we've got three contributions, one from A, one from B, and C is just zero, but we still add C to the equation because that's the general form. So now what do we have? We've got for A, we are going down. So going down is negative. That's going to be minus 20 sine 30 degrees. Okay, so it's the sine. And then here for B, we have a plus because we're going up. So it's plus 91 sine 40. And C has no y component, so we just add 0. So once again, we need to plug this into our calculator. So now what I have is minus 20 sine 30, and then plus 91 sine 40 degrees. So, and you don't need to put the 0, but let's just put it in because some of you will complain. So plus 0. Okay, so what we get is 48.5 if I round off to one decimal. So that's what I got over here, plus 48.5. Okay, so how do we find the magnitude? Remember, we use Pythagoras. It's the square of the x without the signs because these are just magnitudes. So it's 27 squared plus 48.5 squared, and we take the square root. If you do that, you'll get 55.5 kilometers per hour. We need the direction, and we said the direction is given by the inverse 10 of the y component over the x component. The y component is 48.5, and the magnitude of the x is 27.0. If you plug this into your calculator, you get 60.9. The if your calculator is in degrees, as so let's just make sure that we're all happy. So you press shift 10, that will give you the inverse 10. You want a fraction, and you have 48.5 over 27. You don't need the 0.0, but let's put it in so that there's no complaints, and close the bracket. Equals, it gives you 60.9 if you round off to one decimal. 60.9, the unit is degrees because our calculator is in degrees. So then now to quote the final answer, which is a vector, we need the magnitude plus direction. So to do that, it's always useful, and I recommend that you draw out what you have for your final answer. So remember that our x was in the negative direction. So there, it's out of this screen. Yes, so Rx was minus. So minus, then I'm gonna estimate 27 kilometers per hour as the length of that line. So there we go. Then I had 48, which is bigger than 27. So I'm gonna draw a line which is almost twice or 1.5 times the x line. But it's positive, so it's pointed up, and my resultant is from the starting point to the end point. So that's my result, and the length of this line, if you were to measure it, would be 55 kilometers per hour, and the direction it forms with respect to the x-axis, which I've called theta here, is 60.9. So the final answer for your vector is 55.5 kilometers per hour at 60.9 degrees, so north of west or above the negative x-axis. Okay, so that's the final answer for problem number 7. Okay, so now let's have a look. We are going to look at 4 more problems and then we are done for the session. So first off, we are interested in problem number 6. So let's make sure that we are looking at the same problem. So problem number 6, it's still page 39. And what we have there is we are told that the magnitudes of the 4 displacement vectors shown, so these 4 displacement vectors, so here we're speaking about displacement, are for A we have 16 meters, so for A we have 16 meters and it's at an angle 20 degrees with respect to the negative x-axis, and for B we have, where is B? Oh, B is over here. So B is 11 meters in magnitude, and you can see that it's pointed up, so it's positive for the y. It only has a y component. Then we have C, which is 12 meters in magnitude. So there's our C. It forms an angle 55 degrees with respect to the y-axis. We don't like working with these angles. We want the other one. So the other one would be 90 minus 55, which is 35. So that's the angle we are going to work with. And then finally, we have D. So the magnitude of D is 26 meters. And the direction is 50 degrees south of east. Okay. So the question now is, we need to determine the magnitude and directional angle for the resultant that occurs when these vectors are added together. Okay. So what do we have? So once again, there's my solution. So I've already found the angle 35 degrees with respect to the x-axis, written down all the magnitudes, and I've just displaced B. So B was over here, it was below the y-axis, and I just wanna remind us, okay, so just a reminder that if I have a block sitting on a surface and I'm pushing the block with a force F, this is the same, even though it will feel different, as pulling the block from the other side. So if I have a vector directed somewhere from a surface, I can just draw the vector starting from the origin directed in the same direction. So we always want to draw our vectors so that they start from the origin. So in this case, we had B, which started below the origin and it was going up. So we don't want that. So what I did is I translated this vector B, start at the origin and then draw your vector B. So then B is over here. And you can see that B is positive for the y component. So that's very important. And obviously, this is also true for a vector in the x or even in a general direction. If I have a vector like that, the head is at the origin. I don't want that. I want the tail at the origin. So I will start at the origin and draw my vector directed the way it was given. So that's the vector that I would have and not this one. Okay, and here it's very clear that the x is negative and the y is positive. So that's what I'm using. So over here, if we go back, the x component, there are 4 vectors, so I just add the x components of the 4 vectors. I've given them color coding so that it's easier to see. So C is green, D is red, and B is a bold black. I didn't have blue, so, and A is the thin black. Okay, so for A, I'm going in the negative y direction, so I will have minus, the magnitude is 16, and its cos of the angle between the x-axis and the vector, which is 20 degrees. For B, I don't have an x component, so that's 0. For C, it's also negative for the direction. I'm going that way. And the magnitude is 12, and I want the x component, so that's going to be cos of the angle between the vector and the x-axis, which is 35, not the 55. And then plus, finally, we have for D, my x is positive, it's 26 in magnitude, and it's going to be cos 50. I should have put the degree over there, so 50 degrees. Okay, so if you plug these in to your calculator, you find your final answer is minus 8.15. So minus is the direction of the resultant x component. The magnitude is 8.15. We are speaking about displacement, so the unit is meters. Okay, so and then now for the y component, it's the same thing. So we add the four y components for each vector. And for A, I'm going up, so that's a plus, and it's going to be the magnitude times sine of the angle, so 16 sine 20. B only has a y component, so it's plus 11. And then finally, C has a negative y component because it's directed down, so minus 12 sine 35. And finally, D is directed down also, so minus 26 sine 50. So putting this into your calculator, you find that the y component is just 10.3, and it's in the negative direction. Okay, so then how do we find the magnitude? Forget about the signs. So just put in the magnitudes of your x and your y into our famous formula, Pythagoras. So the square root of x squared plus y squared. X is 8.15, y is 10.3, and we get 13.1 meters. And then for our angle, we know that theta is the inverse 10 of the y over the x, so that gives us 51.6 degrees. So then what is the final answer? So remember, I always encourage that for your final answer, you just go back to your vectors and you draw your vector so that you can see exactly how the direction is. So I start off and I draw my x. My x is negative, so it's pointed towards the negative x-axis, and the magnitude is 8.15, so that's the size of the line. And 10 is slightly bigger, so and I've drawn my my y, so there's my y, and it's also down because it's negative, and the size of the line is slightly bigger than the x one. And then my resultant is from my starting point, which is from the x, all the way to the end point. So there's my resultant. The magnitude of this line would be 13.1, and the direction, which is this theta over here, is 51.6. So you can see that this is south of west. So this line is west. I need to go 51.6 degrees south of west. And that's the final answer. Okay, so that's the answer for number 6. And then now we are almost done. Now let's look at question 5. So page 38, we are looking at question 5. So question 5 has the following statement. So let's just close the other questions. So we have a bug, and the bug crawls 4.25 meters along the base of a wall. Upon reaching a corner, the bug's direction of travel changes from south to west. So initially the bug was traveling south, and then it travels west. So south it traveled 4.25 meters, and then it crawled 3.15 meters west before stopping. So now they want to know what is the magnitude of the bug's displacement. Okay, so only the magnitude. If we track the travel of the bug, what we will learn is the bug started off over here. For example, it crawled, well, it walked 4.25 meters south of the wall, and then it started going west for 3.15 meters. Okay, so that's our two vectors. Then they want the magnitude of the displacement. So the magnitude would be the magnitude of the resultant vector. And that's an easy question. We know our famous formula, which is Pythagoras. So magnitude is given by the x component squared plus the y component squared. The x component is 3.15, so 3.15 squared. Y component is 4.25, so 4.25 squared. And the final answer, if you plug this into your calculator, take the square root, is 5.29 meters. Okay, so that's our solution for question 5. Then now let's look at question 3. So I'm interested in question 3. And question 3 asks, which one of the following statements is true concerning scalars, concerning scalar quantities? Okay, so option A, let's just close over here. Okay, so option A says the scalar quantities must be represented by base units, and that's not necessarily true. Scalar quantities, we've just seen that we actually represent them by using a number line, and the magnitude of the number line doesn't have to be 1. So for a base, the magnitude is normally 1, so in this case that's not necessarily true. So A is out. And then scalar quantities have both magnitude and direction. That's also false. Scalar only has magnitude. Direction we don't have for a scalar, so B is also out. So let's just make sure that we cancel A, we cancel B. And then C, so C, scalar quantities can be added to vector quantities using rules of trigonometry. And that's crap, right? You can't add 7 kilograms to, 15 kilometers east. It just doesn't make sense. So adding 10 k's to 15 k's east is nonsense, okay? Because the first 10 k's, which direction was it? So we can't add vectors and scalars. We can only add vectors to vectors and scalars to scalars. So we can't add, okay? So C is out. And then D, scalar quantities can be added to other scalar quantities using rules of trigonometry. That's not the case. So if you just remember how we added scalars, I just wanna remind you of the slide. So let me just find it. We said we add scalars by just adding the magnitudes of the lines in the number line. And if I can just find the page quickly. And trigonometry was only used when we looked at vector components, and we were just adding vectors there. So that's why this is incorrect. Oh, it's over here. So just a reminder, we added scalars by using normal addition of numbers and we kept the unit. So it was just normal addition and we kept the unit. But when we were adding vectors, you know, we broke down the vectors into components and we added using trigonometry. So that's for vectors and not scalars. So then option D, let's just make sure. Okay, so option D is also out. Option E, scalar quantities can be added to other scalar quantities using rules of ordinary addition, and that's the correct option. Okay, so we add scalars using normal addition. Okay, so now let's look at our final question for this section. So the final question says, which one of the following choices is a vector quantity? So a vector, remember, you need a number, a unit, and direction. Mass obviously doesn't have direction. You can't say my mass is 30 kilograms east. That's quite funny. Temperature also is a scalar. Time, you don't say I will meet you after 2 hours south. That doesn't make sense, so there's no direction. Displacement is a vector, so that's our final answer. But just to complete, to check, so E is volume, and if I have 2 liters of water, I don't speak of direction, so I never have 2 liters of water south. So The correct answer in this case is D. Okay, so let's just recap what we did today. So we looked at vectors and scalars, and we said we will start off. So we started off, we defined what a scalar is and what a vector is, and we learned that a scalar is a number plus a unit, a vector is a number plus a unit plus direction, and we used arrows to represent vectors, which was a promotion of number lines from scalars. And then we moved on and we said normally we can add numbers by counting. For scalars we add by measuring the result, so we add numbers and write down the unit. So how do we then add for vectors? That was our next section. And we said the rule was we add vectors using head to tail. And if you subtract a vector, you just reverse the direction of the vector, keep the same magnitude, and you just add the vectors as if the other one was reversed. So the one you are subtracting, you reverse the direction. And then after that, we said, okay, but then we can't calculate, it's very difficult to calculate using that. Is there any simple way? And the simple way was we realized that every vector has two components, and that was our holy grail. It has an x component and a y component. And from the two components, then we added vectors using components. And so a resultant, if you have four vectors, was to add the four x components, you get the resultant x component, and then you add the four y components to get the resultant y component, and then to get the magnitude, you just use Pythagoras to get the direction, use 10 theta, and that's how we used vector components to calculate. And this is very accurate, it's an accurate method. It has nothing to do with your drawing skills, which was how we did 1.6. And then finally we exploited vector components for our addition, and we looked at the questions. Okay, so thanks, that is the end, and I hope that you find this lecture very useful. And yeah, if you don't understand it, you can just repeat. Okay, thank you.